Good morning, everybody, and welcome again to our Sunday show called What's Going On Here. My name is Bob Venne, Calvin Kastein with the camera, and we're with you every Sunday. New and different things, and today we're doing something we've been trying to do for several years. Very difficult to find what was formerly known as the blacksmith. I'm not sure they're still called blacksmiths today. I don't know why they wouldn't be. We looked around, looked for a big elm tree, and right underneath it, and
We're looking for a chestnut tree.
Right. Okay. And you look around for a nut, and they say, then you'll find a blacksmith.
You'll find a blacksmith.
but we didn't. You can't find the chestnut tree around here.
The you found the nut, though.
The spreading chestnut tree. And the name of our potential victim here.
George Weidle.
George Weidle. How do you spell Weidle?
W-E-I-D-L-E.
All right. First thing I would say up here is that is not a northern New York name.
Absolutely not. Replaced from New Jersey.
You came from New Jersey?
Central New Jersey, probably 18 years ago now.
You've been up here 18?
Mm-hmm.
What brought you to the North Country?
Love of the country. Tired of the city.
How'd you know about this?
I saw an ad in the paper down there. It was the Herald News for property for sale up here. And it was the middle of January, and I threw my wife in the van and my kids, and we took a ride.
That ought to scare you right there in the middle of January.
Well, when we got here halfway up the Northway, they had closed the Northway behind us, and they closed the Northway ahead of us. I said, what have we gotten into? Well, we made it to Plattsburgh and stayed at the Holiday Inn, and from there we just bought this piece of property.
What were you doing before, George?
Well,
you went too old.
At the time, I was a truck mechanic.
Truck mechanic, okay.
Large trucks, diesels, tractor trailers.
And the nationality for Weidel?
German.
German?
German.
And your mom and dad still living?
My mother is. My father passed away. My mother's remarried. Uh-huh. She lives in Rouse's Point.
Rouse's Point?
Mm-hmm.
You want to give us her married name?
Markowitz.
Markowitz.
Right on Lake Street.
Okay. So she may watch Hometown Cable.
Absolutely.
We
She'll
see
hear
you got
her name.
You got an RCA dish on the top, so you probably don't see, but you can go to mom's and watch this program.
Absolutely.
All right. What were you going to do when you got here? Did you have any idea?
I knew I could always find the position as a truck mechanic. There's trucks no matter where you go. But I've done it for, at that point, probably 15 years, and I've just continued on up here, and there was not a lot of money in it, and I had just gotten tired of it. Mm-hmm. I was just burnt out.
Okay. You were raised in New Jersey?
Absolutely.
With raising children in New Jersey, depending where you are, can be a...
It's tough.
Yes, it is.
It's now, tough.
How big a family do you have?
Two children.
How old are they?
My daughter's 27.
Oh.
And my son is 22.
Well, they're both out of school. No one knows them from school then.
They all went to school here. They both went to school here.
At Northeastern?
Northeastern Clinton. Both graduated from Northeastern Clinton.
Okay. So, before you came up here that January, did you find a place when you came up that January?
Actually, we found this place. We looked at a place in Shazy, and we ended up coming up here. He had another piece that he wanted to show us, and we came and looked at it, and we decided to come here.
Was it hollowed out then, or did
No.
you do this?
No, I did it. It was just
you
a woodlot.
Set it up just the way you like.
Right.
Before that January, did you have the weather protector on your chin like that?
That's a funny story.
Go ahead.
I had it. I had had a beard for maybe a year or two. And my son was about 3 years old, and I just decided to shave it off one day. And I shaved it off and cut my hair real short, and I walked out of the bathroom, and my dog almost bit me, and I had a big German Shepherd, and my son came out, and he got scared, and he went and he dug all the hair out of the waste paper basket and wanted
Is that
me to
right?
put it back on, and that was the last time I shaved it.
I would think for a blacksmith that could be very dangerous. With the sparks flying and so forth.
Not so much the sparks. Actually, it's probably a little bit of a protector.
It is. Oh, well, that's true.
It stops the sparks from getting too close to the skin. You may burn a whisker or two, but...
That's all right. It's already kind of gray.
Absolutely.
You put the gray in, right? Because that's
No. That comes with two kids, 27 and 22.
It does come with that? All right. When did you move up then? We're talking January now of...
We had had the property probably 2.5-3 years.
And
okay. We'd come up and spend, like, Memorial Day weekend for a week or so and cut trees. And we just finally said, well, we're far enough along. We bought a log cabin kit, and we came up and did it.
The biggest problem you would have doing what you're doing here, the average married person would be his wife.
She was 100% for it.
Very good.
100% for it.
So you kept making it bigger and bigger
just
in here?
Just kept making it bigger and bigger. And
you built your own home?
Built my home. And They're nice. Log cabins or log cabins, log homes are very efficient as far as energy consumption. A lot of people think they're cold, they think they're drafty, but they're not.
Am I correct in calling you a blacksmith?
I hope so. I'd say almost an aspiring blacksmith. I'm learning all the time.
Is there a description of a title of blacksmith? I think when I see an anvil and a man is using a forge, to me, he's a blacksmith.
Technically, yes. A lot of people today have the misconception that a blacksmith, all he ever did was shoe horses. And that's mainly a fallacy. A blacksmith, 150, 200 years ago, a community would run an ad in the paper, invite a blacksmith to come live in their community. In turn, they'd give him free land, free food, all the help he needed.
Yeah, he made anything they needed out of metal.
Absolutely. Without a blacksmith in a community, you had no community.
Mm-hmm.
There was no local aubergine or true value. You had to see the blacksmith. He made the nails to build your houses. He made the tools to build the to hammer the nails. He made the tools to work the land. He did everything.
Well, you can see we've got a very pleasant person to talk with this morning. And we're going to take a short break and come back and talk with George. Can I call you George?
Absolutely.
The last time I said Mr. Weidle, I don't think I ever did say Mr. Weidle.
No, sir, and so I hope you don't.
It'll be George when we come back. Thank you for tuning in to Hometown Cable. We moved into the building, and it's easy to see, looking at his benches, that he hasn't been here too many years. Because I remember Bert LaFountain and Ray Bittard. That has to be a foot high all over, or you haven't been there very long.
Well, I'll tell you what, if you would have been here an hour ago, you would have seen my son running around like maniacs.
You've cleaned up.
We've cleaned
like
up
the wives do, huh?
So we can see the top of the workbenches anyhow. When we built the shop, I told my son, he said, Dad, one workbench isn't enough. I said, it's more than enough when you go to clean it. You'll find that out.
And you save every little piece, right?
Absolutely.
No. All right, so after you, while you were building the house, did you have income of some kind? Were you working out?
I was fortunate. I had come up here one time right after I bought the property, and I was working for Diamond Rio Trucks at the time, and Steve Monty owned Champlain Auto Truck Center at the Shell Station. He needed a part for his Diamond Rio wrecker, and my employer at the time knew I was coming up here. He said, here, deliver this part up there for me. So I had met Steve Monty and talked to him a little bit, told him about New Jersey and what I did down there. And when I finally did come up here, I looked him up again, and he put me to work there for a little while. So I had some income. It was hard.
So you're pretty universal what you can do. You mentioned carpentry work?
I'm a union carpenter right now, but with the state budget the way it is, things aren't all that great for union carpenters, so... I probably change vocations as often as I change my socks, according to my wife.
So,
this is a lot of fun, though.
Right, so you can do, can I say, just about anything if it's mechanical?
Pretty much so. Carpentry, I've worked in the woods since I've been up here as a logger. I've worked at the sawmill for Felix Misak when he had that operating. I've worked for two or three different trucking companies. I've worked as a mason, I do electrician, plumbing.
Okay, I got to ask you the next question now. How many times since the last 18 years have you said to yourself, I wonder if I ever should have come up here?
I don't think that has been a question. I'm not sorry I came up here. Economics up here are entirely different than they are
in a city.
Absolutely not. Down in the cities, wages are tremendously higher. But as you say, you don't need as much to get by, survive. I'm not interested in becoming wealthy as long as I can pay my bills. And
you're succeeding at that too?
Absolutely, so far.
You haven't violated being wealthy at all?
Not at all.
Okay, we're moved into the shop. That's why it's a little darker in here. Behind him is the, I guess you got to say, the central place of any blacksmith. So we're going to have to say that George is more than a blacksmith, but we're doing blacksmithing right now. And this is the forge.
This is the forge.
All right. Do you buy this unit?
Well, I happened to get real lucky. I was working for Mickey Tatrell. And I was helping him clean out something in the shop or something. We were upstairs, and I came across the fire pot and the blower. And I asked him about it. He said, oh, that's my father's. He said he bought that when he was 16 or 17, and he never set it up. And I said, does he want to sell it? He said, well, he said, my father never sells nothing. He said, you can ask him. So I asked Mike Sr., and he said, well, my boy, he said, I never sell nothing. He says, but I've had that since I was 17, and if you want it, he says, you can have it for $50 as long as I can come down and watch your work and play with it.
There you are.
I said, absolutely.
Michael 9B, we're talking about. Mickey's the person we talked to at the Shazee home show. We talked with him there. He won one of the first two prizes to get. Won a lunch bucket. Mickey did. So when you said the fire pot, does that mean there's a metal unit
right
in there?
Underneath there's a cast iron metal unit. It's about 13 by 9.5, 10 inches. It's got a what they call a clinker breaker in the bottom for when your coal gets hard and glassy. It'll stop the airflow. So you have the breaker that'll shake the ash and the clinkers out.
It falls down here.
And it falls down here. And then there's a trap at the bottom where the ash falls right through.
Mm-hmm. And this is something that was part of it?
This came with it. He had bought this at the same time. It's a hand crank blower. This is probably early 1900s, late 1800s. The earlier blacksmiths would have a double acting bellows, which would either hang from the ceiling or be mounted somewhere out of the way. It was made of leather. Either one, all they did, their primary function was to supply air to the fire.
If you ever wonder if blacksmiths know what duct tape is, the answer is yes.
Absolutely.
There is duct tape. Duct tape will hold things together.
It'll
when
hold
nothing else
together.
Will. Right. And it just sort of don't slip down. That's all.
Right.
It doesn't have any big function, but there it is. So you buy your coal in a...
The coal is the hardest part of the whole operation.
How's that?
The only place I can buy this coal is in Rutland, Vermont, for a reasonable price. There is no place where you can buy bituminous coal in this area.
It's a special coal?
It's a special... This is a low-sulfur smithing coal, they call it. It's soft coal. You can buy anthracite coal locally, which is hard coal. But it's harder to keep going. You need an electric blower, and it's not as easy to work with.
You're a mason, so you built your own?
I built the old masonry forge. Actually, these bricks came from the old Lucian's Tavern after they had the fire. So a friend of mine did some work there, and he said, yeah, if you want some of them bricks, take them.
There you are. And this you made?
This I made. The hood came from a place that I disassembled for a guy. The blower was off of an old mobile home heating furnace. My wife says I have a blacksmith mentality. Save everything and make everything work.
Well, that there's a place for everything. Just looking here, you see that piece of metal? That's nearly a half inch or more thick.
It's probably 5/8.
5/8, and he just cut a piece out he wanted.
Mm-hmm.
You do that with a torch?
I have torches, acetylene torches.
You just cut that piece out, then he worked it out, whatever he wanted to do. Okay, this is a block of wood.
Right.
Now, I don't know if I've ever seen this before, but he's then used what, well, I thought, I was thinking he had a staple, but he has a big spike that he's bent over to make a tool rack all around it. Is this common? I don't remember seeing that.
I don't know if they use nails as much as they would use a leather strap.
They did have those be around
the
block?
They would have a leather strap around the block to hold their hammers and tools and things they used often.
Well, I would think at the end of a night, this seems a little low to me. Would that bother your back after all day long?
If you get into the habit of bending over to do your work, absolutely.
You stand straight at that,
I stand straight as much as I can. The rule of thumb is the anvil should reach the blacksmith's knuckles as he's standing in a relaxed position. I would find that with smaller work, another inch or two higher would be beneficial.
Okay.
Because you're not...
And you could have a large thing you could put. Of course, you can't lift that to put it on something, can you?
I can lift it, but it's a chore.
Okay, we're going to take a break, but before we do, where do you find an anvil? They're tough to find.
They are hard to find.
Well, I was right. They are very hard.
A couple of friends of mine had gone to an auction down, I think, in Peru. One of the orchards was closing up.
Yes.
And I had told them that
the
if
green.
You ever... Green's Orchard, I think it was.
Yep.
I said, if you ever come across an anvil, I said, I'll pay $1 a pound. Well, they heard the anvil going up for auction, and I guess they both went running, and they ended up buying me this anvil for $60, which was this is worth its weight in gold.
Oh, yes.
The anvil is in perfect condition. The table is tight. It's flat. It's a Peter Wright anvil.
It sure hasn't been used a lot either, has it?
Nope.
Doesn't look like it. Looks like it's in very good shape.
It's in excellent condition. It's even marked with the old markings they used on anvils. They marked them by means of hundredweight. They would have a series of numbers. The first hundredweight on an anvil is 112 pounds. The second number would be hundredweight in quarter pounds, quarter of a hundred. And the third number would be pounds proper.
So what are we saying the weight of this one?
This anvil is 112 plus 28 would be 140 plus 12 pounds would be 152 pounds. For the anvil alone.
So that it's harder to find it than it is to pay for it.
Absolutely. It's harder to find it than it is to pick it up.
Yep, and it's like the old butcher blocks. Now, I notice you got this, and also he's got a vise on legs.
Right.
That can be moved around if you're so disposed to lift that much.
That vise was going to the trash, and I got the vise for nothing and made the legs.
Now, this man's got some of my traits, I'll tell you. You can get something for nothing or just find it secondhand and use it. But he's got the knowledge of something that I don't have to do with it when I got it. We'll be right back. We're talking with George Weidle. He's a blacksmith. They call him a modern blacksmith. We're on the North Star Road. We'll tell you later how to get to him, how you can have a phone.
Absolutely.
You're not adverse to a phone.
Not at all.
We'll give you his number later on, so keep a pencil handy. And if you ever see him on the street, you're not going to miss. He and is it Joe Gregoire and Shazy? Don't miss, you know Joe Gregoire?
I've heard the name.
He has the beard. Don't get him mixed up. But I always recognize him when I see it. We'll be right back. Now, at home, people say I have a lot of things. I have a lot of stuff. Some of this is stuff. If you had this, where would you store it? Or what would you do with it? How did you get this? And tell us what this is.
This is the remains of three farm wagons. Mike Tatrell, Mickey Tatrell, I used to work for him, I still do off and on, called me up and said they're going to bulldoze the top hedgerow up at his father's farm. He said there's a lot of wagon pieces there. He said if you want them, go get them before they disappear.
Mm-hmm.
So I went up there with a friend of mine, Teddy Belrose from Champlain, and we started poking around, and what we came up with was what you see here. That's one complete wagon here. Front and rear axle, what's left of it. There's another complete wagon in the background. There's a pair of axles there with the bolsters, what's left of them. And this is the front axle off of a medium-sized to light farm wagon, single horse. So hopefully someday I'll get to restore them, rebuild them.
That's a big project.
It is. It takes a lot of work.
This is more work than building from scratch, isn't it?
It can be. It can be. It's harder sometimes, people don't believe, to restore or repair something than it is to build from scratch.
Oh, yeah, because you got to be precise building within the rim, right?
Right. There again, you have a little bit of leeway. The steel tire is shrunk onto the wooden wheel.
It's shrunk on?
It's shrunk on. What you do is you assemble your wooden wheel, you cut your spokes. The outside wooden part are called fellies, the sections. After you build that, you have a tool that you measure the outside diameter, you roll your steel tire, and you make your steel tire between 3/8 and a half of an inch shorter in circumference, and you do the wooden wheel. After you do that, you take your steel tire and you heat it up to just below red heat, where it expands enough, and then you pound it on your wooden wheel real quick and cool it off before it sets the wheel on fire.
And it's not attached at all?
It's
just
not
shrunk on there?
Normally they were just shrunk. Some of the later wagons, some of the real heavy-duty wagons would have what they call tire bolts. I can show you on another wagon.
Mm-hmm.
These are probably early 1900s. These are steam-bent fellies, the outside wooden part. There are just two pieces instead of normally they would be six.
But these are curved more. The wood is curved more with four, you said, how many? Three?
These are two pieces.
Two pieces.
Two pieces.
So they're curved much more than a six.
Right. They're curved much more than a six piece.
Okay. And this is a one bottom plow.
Right.
That
I want to restore that too.
Mm-hmm. When you restore that, what will happen to it after?
I don't know. I don't know if I'm just going to end up owning it forever. making a decoration out of it.
Trying to sell it for someone else for a decoration?
Trying to sell it for a decoration. I'd rather much love to see somebody with a nice big draft horse that wants to go out and try plowing a field with it.
That's work. People don't do that as much, George, as they used to.
Absolutely, it's work.
It's a lot of work.
But if we can do it just so the kids can see how much work it was. I mean, you didn't drive in an air-conditioned tractor with the stereo going with a six-bottom plow behind
you. No, back when they were using these in 1900, the blacksmith wasn't building the whole wagon, was he?
No, they were coming out of factories. Studebaker had a factory. Owensboro built wagons. There was a lot of wagon factories back then.
And you had wheelwrights that built wheels?
Right, you had wheelwrights. There was a lot of specialty trades. There was the wheelwright. The wagon builder would be called a Wainwright. It became specialty during the Industrial Revolution there. People could buy things faster and cheaper from factories than they could from a local blacksmith.
Now, it's not very often we have somebody who leads us right into the next thing when he talks about a Wainwright who does what?
Wainwright was the wagon builder.
Well, look what we got behind Calvin. Right over here, we talked about, and you saw it probably in the background before, and look at this. Did you know a Wainwright that built this?
No, unfortunately, I became a Wainwright building this, and I became a wheelwright building this, and the blacksmith building this.
Now, this was your first attempt?
This was my first attempt.
And this was sold before you made it?
Right, this was sold before I made it. Actually, the woman had bought three mules for a good price, and she decided that she wanted to have a wagon to go with the team that drove. And she approached me, asked me if I could build her a wagon, and I said, yep. I said, I can do it, and I gave her a ridiculously low figure because I had no idea what I was getting into. After I put 350 hours in it, it was finished, and she was really happy, and she was more than fair. She gave me a good bonus.
She did.
Absolutely.
Well, I think maybe when you, she probably was so excited when she went home after you quoted her the first time, not knowing, you know, that maybe the amount of work, but.
Actually, she had no idea what she was going to get for the price. She thought I was going to take a hay wagon running gear and put a wooden box on it and tell her that was a wagon. But as I started building it and it progressed, she got more enthusiastic and more excited, and she wanted traditional. She wanted wooden wheels, wooden spokes, as traditional as was practical.
You built the hub?
No,
those you were able to buy?
For the sense of practicality, we bought the wheel parts. They all come from an Amish community in Lancaster, Pennsylvania.
Ah, yes, yes.
They're one of the few places where you can still buy these parts. We bought the hubs. The spokes come in rough length, and I bought the wooden part, which is called the felly from them. They're steam bent.
Okay.
The steel tires came as a strip of steel. We rolled them, and these have tire bolts in them.
I see. So that you'll notice the metal that holds the two together, there's six sections, comes up through here, and then the top is
bolted right through.
Bolted, and would you call that a, when you hammer, I forgot what my name I want to use. Rivet, is that riveted?
No, they're not riveted. They're a tire bolt. I think I have some inside I can show you.
This is the piece that goes down with the thread that comes in from the other side.
It's got a serrated edge halfway down through, and then it's threaded on the opposite end with a quarter-inch nut on it.
Okay, it comes in from behind. Okay.
These are not absolutely necessary, but to make it a little bit stronger and safer for giving commercial rides on pavement, we bolted them on.
That's, what, 3/8 of an inch?
The steel tire is 3/8 by 2 inches wide.
Look at the thickness on that, and that is not going to wear out.
No, not in a hurry.
Not in her age or relative. So tell us a little bit about what you have and what do you use? They don't sell plans for these.
No, I watched TV and looked at books and kept looking at wagons and just started building it. The running gear, all the framework underneath is red oak. That would vary from locality to locality. Whatever hardwood was abundant and long-lived, it could be red oak, white oak, hickory, beech they would use. I happen to have red oak, so that's what I made the wagon frame out of, the running gear they call it. The body itself is made of ash. It's locally grown ash that was cut here. The body brackets are red oak because I had some of that left. The hubs are elm. They come from, like I say, the Amish in Lancaster. The spokes are beech and maple, and the fellies, the wooden parts on the outside,
these here,
are steam bent beech.
Now, there is the basic frame of the wagon,
right,
which includes this,
right.
Those, and then the box,
right,
sits on there.
The body, the box, just sits right on the running
gear.
Is
it bolted on there?
There's no attachment at all. They sit on the bolster brackets, they call them,
uh-huh,
right here.
So that lifts right up, see?
Lift right off. They could use it for hauling logs if they had to by taking the body off of it.
And then you'd have the sides to hold,
right? The sides and the tie-down rings, and that's why they're on there.
Those are tie-down rings, all right.
This body could be used on a sleigh gear if you had a sleigh for the winter.
Okay, and if you wanted to not use it with a seat, the seat lifts off, too.
The seat lifts right off.
That's not fastened.
Nope, that just hangs on the side of the body.
And that lifts right off, then you'd have an open wagon to use,
right,
an open box.
Mm-hmm.
Did you learn a lot? Could you do it in less than 23 hours now? 300 hours.
300 hours? I would say so. Like I said, it was a learning process for me, absolutely. There's no question about that. But it gives you a great appreciation for what they had
to do. Oh, I'm sure. Of course. And the lady saw fit to put a little brass plate on the side, not only with her name and her farm, but George's name, because it was built. And there's a lot of pride in owning something that was handmade for you. Did you make these brackets, too?
Everything.
You made all of those?
Made all the iron on it. The only thing that was bought were the wheel parts and the springs for the seat.
Mm-hmm.
It was to the point where, just to be practical, we had to buy a few things.
Yeah.
I'd like to have made the springs, but like I said, we had to be a little bit practical.
You mentioned earlier just the four wheels run the better part of $1,000.
The parts for the four wheels
are
$930. To buy the four complete wheels from the Amish was about $1,300.
Already up.
Already assembled.
Okay, and you make the
I make the weather vanes. This one is a llama. I have another one that I made for a woman up in Saranac. I have to make a sign for her. It's a lot of fun.
Okay.
People appreciate handmade things.
They sure do. You got, that's the imitation well you got there for, isn't it?
Right. That just covers my well casing.
Okay.
I didn't like
it
seeing
it. It does cover your well casing.
Right.
Right. Now, you look around the yard. It has no signs out front. Is that something that is likely to come?
Hopefully.
Okay.
Hopefully. I'm working on that, putting up a sign, Blacksmith, out front.
Okay. We'll take a short break. You're watching Hometown Cable. This is George Weidle. I'm Bob Venn. That's Calvin Kastein. You know who you are? Come right back. We're coming back. You see, I'm a babes in the wood here. When they tell me something, I don't know if it's right or not. But George just said, that's the proverbial green smoke. So that smoke coming off the side here, that's green smoke?
That's green smoke.
What is green smoke?
That's the unburnt coal, the green coal that you put in. It's burning off the impurities right now and the sulfur that's in it, even though it is a low sulfur coal. When it's burning green like that, it's really not good for forging. You can't weld with it at all. There's too many impurities in it, which affects the weld. What you want is a nice coked fire where the impurities are burnt off of the coal, and you'll have a nice blue flame there after a while.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have a real hot, clean fire. Forge will reach temperatures of 3,000
degrees.
Wow,
look at this. Can you leave that in there too long?
Absolutely. You can leave it in there till you have no iron left.
It would just burn? Yeah.
It would burn right away. You would have nothing there.
Uh-huh.
I can bring that up to welding heat here in a second for you, even though it wouldn't be a good weld. At welding heat, you'll see a lot of spark coming off of your iron. Unfortunately, even iron is hard to come by today. Pure wrought iron, it's all mild steel that you buy locally.
All right, perfect time. Iron and steel, what's the difference?
Wrought iron has no, or very, very low carbon content. There's no carbon in it. It's a softer, more malleable iron. Steel, on the other hand, mild steel has a percentage of carbon in it, which makes it a little bit stiffer and stronger per se, but not tougher. It makes it harder to weld. See, that's just about welding heat.
Oh, I see the little sparks. Yes.
Sparks coming off of it.
Yep.
That's where the steel is starting to burn and melt away.
Okay.
Wrought iron has a higher melting point. It won't spark quite as fast.
Can I tell whether this is iron or steel? Are those all steel?
This is steel. I think all of these are steel. None of these are really that old.
Uh-huh.
They're pieces that I find. They're...
You find those at garage sales and flea markets and so forth? Or where do you find those?
Very rarely. Primarily, a blacksmith made all his own tongs. He made his own hammers. The blacksmith was the only craftsperson that made his own tools to pursue his craft. To find blacksmithing tools today is really hard. There's a lot of collectors out there buying them up, and they just want to put them on display, and you really have to be faster or have an inside track to find them.
Have you ever met Clayton Grew, for instance, in Perry's Mills?
No, I haven't. I wish I would have. I'd love to talk to old blacksmiths.
He must have tools left around.
There's tools down there, but his grandson, I think it is, or nephew, Danny Grew, wants to keep them all intact in the shop.
Well, of course, they went back to a grandfather.
They went back to the grandfathers.
They go back from it. And, of course, there's Raymond Bedard had some of these.
Absolutely.
He's not, I don't know if he still operates at all, I don't think with a forge anymore.
He's not operating. He hasn't done any forging in years, from what I understand.
Mm-hmm.
He is retired now. He's living with his daughter.
Well, he's moved out?
He's moved out. He lives with his daughter now.
Okay. He certainly... Now, we must mention, I guess, do you know him as George Bedard?
Raymond?
George. Raymond, do you know him as Raymond?
Well, when I came up here, I didn't know him as Raymond Bedard. I just knew him as the spitter. I'd go down there and people would say, well, I got to go down to the spitters and buy a chainsaw chain. And it took me a while before I found out who the spitter was and his real name. Yeah. But
you know, I had never really heard that name for him either. Until just a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But he had that chew of tobacco all the time. And
all the time.
As he's talking to you.
All the time.
My father from the farm used to go in there, and that's what I say, his was crowded, hanging all over.
Absolutely.
But he could go over and dig through and find what he was looking for.
He knew exactly where it was.
Where he was, and he didn't have the help. I think he did everything himself all the time.
Pretty much. I gave him a lot of credit. Even towards the end there, to lift something off of the top shelf, he'd have to take one arm and lift the other arm to get it down. You didn't dare offer to do it for him either.
Very difficult. That fire really must have really devastated him.
Absolutely.
Personally as
it's
well as financially. Okay, can we leave that and go over,
sure.
Just take before we take another break,
sure.
Explain what this is. The basic wagon.
This is a running gear that a woman bought at an auction over in Allbirds. This is the basic wagon frame. They called it the running gear. She got the front axle with the wheels and the rear axle with the wheels. This is just a piece of pine I put in here for now, temporary, which they call that the reach. So I have to get a piece of hardwood, either red oak or white oak.
Pine wouldn't last long.
Pine would not last long.
Okay, so this is just to hold in position,
right,
so you can see.
Right, that's just temporary holding.
Will that be ash or something you'd put in there?
If I can, I'm going to get white oak for that.
Okay.
White oak is a little more weather resistant, rot resistant than red. They're both about as strong.
There's your...
That's the front bolster.
This is the bolster is the whole unit?
This is what they call the bolster.
Uh-huh.
These are the bolster brackets.
Uh-huh.
This has to pivot so that when the front axle turns on the hound...
That stays...
This stays in a straight line with your body.
Mm-hmm.
There's normally
there's no
a large...
Pin. There's a pin that goes
right, through. There's a large pin that goes all the
right.
way down through. On the older farm wagons, not on the one I built, but... The traditional farm wagons were pretty much adjustable. They would not be attached right here. There'd be a series of holes drilled in the reach, and they could adjust the wheelbase on the wagon for different situations.
Okay. Through this hole right here?
Through this hole in the hound plate.
This is in pretty good shape other than the...
This is in excellent shape. The front wheels are still serviceable. The back ones
are... See, they're wired.
They're wired on with old baling wire. A farmer got a few more years out of it by putting wire on the tires.
Those are not used for chains in the winter.
No, absolutely not.
When they shrunk them on, they've kind of expanded, or the inside has shrunk, and now they don't hold
what
on.
What happened, the wood probably shrunk and wore enough from the constant pounding that they're not really tight.
So what would you do now to hold those on? put on some of those special deals like...
No, I wouldn't. What I would do, the fellies on this one are pretty much dry rotted. They're splitting out.
Oh, so you would replace those?
I'd replace the outside wooden fellies and then measure it and cut the tire to within a half an inch shorter of the outside wooden wheel and re-shrink it on.
Ever done that?
I've done it on that wagon outside. We have some of the tools right here. This is what they call a wheel traveler. This is what you use to measure the outside wooden wheel and the outside steel tire.
Oh my, that's not light. So it goes like this.
Right. You would get a known starting point, mark your piece or whatever, mm-hmm. start at zero on your wheel. One complete revolution back to zero is 24 inches, 2 foot.
And this, every time it goes around, it moves one?
Nope, this doesn't move at all. What you do is after you make a complete revolution, you come back to your starting point, you would set your pointer to where you ended up.
Oh, and then you just go to another?
Then you would do the tire and subtract approximately a half an inch from your wooden wheel measurement to make the tire smaller than the wood.
Mm-hmm.
When you did that, you could heat your steel tire in the forge or a fire or whatever. It would expand that half an inch. You would pound it onto the wooden wheel and then douse it with water real quick, and it would shrink tight onto the wheel to hold everything together.
Let me tell you what I thought.
Absolutely.
I thought when you made the rim that it might slope, that the outside diameter might be a quarter inch or something less than the inside, that it kind of tipped.
Right, so it would be kind
of... So that you would kind of shove it in like you would a... you know, yeah, it was kind of like a cone.
Like a cone
yeah,
shape, right.
But that doesn't happen.
Nope, that doesn't happen.
These are flat.
These are flat, but just a half an inch smaller in diameter than the wooden wheel.
How do you heat something that big in a forge?
I tried.
You can't, huh?
You can't. I don't have a big enough forge. Maybe they did at the time. What I think, what I'm going to do the next time... is build a fire
build
pit
a
outside.
Build a fire outside and put it in.
I'm going to put all the scrap wood in, get a good bed of coals, put the steel tire in there, let it absorb the heat.
That's got to get real hot, though.
It's got to get pretty hot. I was talking to a person in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, in the Amish community. He said a good way to test it, he said, take two scraps of wood, a piece of soft wood and a piece of hardwood. He said, when you rub the soft wood on it, if it bursts into flames, it's... right about the right temperature. If the hardwood doesn't burst into flame, just smoke, he says, you know you're right. He said, if the hardwood starts to burn, then you're too hot.
Now, someone out there is going to say, you've got your wooden wheel lying on the floor here, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got this, what temperature outside, maybe 300, 500?
It's probably around 700, 800 degrees.
It's 3 feet in diameter, and you've got to carry it from there to here quickly before it starts to shrink. And you carry use those tongs of yours?
Use the tongs.
That's tough.
What I did those steel tires by myself primarily. They had tools that they used for two men. This is a little clip I made. And all this did was clip onto the steel tire
mm-hmm.
and go over the wooden rim to hold the tire down onto the rim on one side. That way it couldn't pop back up, you know, when you're trying to get something too tight over another article. I have another tool that I made to push down on the opposite side, and you got to push down, clip that on, and have a sledgehammer right there and pound the wheel.
And ready to go, and this won't let it...
let it pop back
if
off.
If you've tried to put a cover on a can, and as you push down one side,
the other side is popping.
You go on the other one, the other pops up, this provides it,
stops it from
popping out.
That can make it a one-man operation.
Have you ever got three quarters on, couldn't get on anymore?
No.
That'd be pretty hard to get off, wouldn't it?
It was scary. When I built that wagon, I lost 3 months sleep worrying about doing that. I had never done it, and I've heard horror stories from a lot of people.
I would think so.
When I ordered the parts, the Amish said, be careful. He said, we burned up more wheels here than we care to admit, and we do a lot of them, he said.
All right, we're going to take another short break, and then we'll move over and show what he can do other than wagons. I think would this more or less complete the wagon story? Anything you want to tell me about the wagon that we haven't covered?
No, that's pretty much it. I think we've covered most of it, the wheels and the wood.
How nice to have a place to work on and not have to push stuff aside as you get ready.
You see me an hour ago.
Is that right?
Cleaning the bench off.
Yes, because you've got to have a place to work and set up.
Right.
All right. We're talking wheels here now. This is mostly wheel material?
Right, these are wheel tools.
Okay.
This would be a raw spoke. When you figure the diameter of your wheel, you would cut the spoke off to the length you needed. You would take this tool, they call it a spoke pointer. These are all hand tools, you use them with a hand brace. What you would do is chuck this one in the hand brace, and it would taper the end of your spoke down to a point. You'd bring the point down to the diameter of the dowel you wanted on the end. Then you would use the tenon cutter, they called it. It's got a knife here. It would cut a round dowel shape on the end of your spoke that would fit through the wooden part in your wheel.
So you're saying that you would take the excess material along and you would have, how am I going to explain this? A flange. It's hard to visualize for people what we're talking about.
Well, I've got a spoke here. If you've got 2 minutes, I'll
okay.
show you how it works.
Okay, all right. Okay. Let's do that.
Norm, I'll do the device here for now, though.
All right.
Just give you an idea how it works.
You would do it mounted in the hub, of course.
Right.
This end goes into the hub first. Well, there's what you're talking about at the other end.
Right, that's tenon for the hub.
And you'd make that with this end, only it would be round instead.
Right, this end would be cut traditionally with a handsaw and a chisel maybe. After you fit them in the mortises in your hub, you would figure your diameter. This tool here goes on. I've got that a little high, but all this tool does is bring your spoke down to a point.
Like a pencil sharpener.
Absolutely, the same exact principle.
That's what a pencil sharpener does, see? You keep going.
Keep going until it stops cutting because you set your depth with a stop right here.
You're down so far, and there's the beginning, right?
That's the beginning. That's the
And that's as far as you would go?
That's as far as you go with this tool.
Okay.
And you would put this tool in, which is the tenon cutter, they called it. It's got a knife right here. You would start it on the center. And you'd start turning, and you'd keep turning.
Right.
What that does?
There you go. This is what I wanted to make you realize what he was talking about. And I should have said, this would be something like you have in a spoke in a chair. You'll notice, right? And there's a setback here. And that goes right up against.
Right.
It don't have to be any deeper than that?
It would depend on the size of the wooden belly on the wheel.
Okay.
If it was 2 to 3 inches, that's the depth it would have to be.
See, unfortunately, everything you do in here, you have to have a separate tool.
Pretty much.
Except your ingenuity, what you can do with that hammer and that forge.
Right.
Because that you can pound out. But basically, you have to have a separate tool. There's two separate tools to get that little flange right there.
Just to do that one part.
Okay. All right.
It is a lot of work.
Now, something else you wouldn't normally see, a motor.
Right, I have a 22-year-old son, and we've got to keep with the modern stuff, too.
He works on motors, too? Does he?
He enjoys it. He likes building motors, tinkering, playing. It's a lot of fun.
Okay. We'll take a short break and come right back. Thanks, George. If you've seen the pictures and you've seen the movies, Blacksmith does not look at home unless he's at the forge or the anvil. And we've got him at both right here. Now, you've been heating this something you made, right?
Right. This is a traditional campfire tripod, they would call it. It would break down into three pieces. You would stand it over your campfire, and you could hang a cooking pot off of it. Today, they're popular. People put them in their yard with a pot in them and a planted flower. I'm making this for another woman. She wanted one. Right now, I'm just putting a point on the end so you can stick it into the ground a little bit.
I was talking with one lady at the cemetery who had some flowers between two graves, very close. And I said, you know, instead of having down there, if you had a little something that held, you could hold that flower 2 feet off the ground.
Right.
And it would look very nice between them, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I had in mind right there,
yeah.
Something like that.
I make the shepherd's crook plant hangers. I make these. I don't make a lot in advance. What we're doing right now is drawing the end to a point so you can stick it into the ground a little bit and it won't slide away on you.
You see that little tap there? That's where it gets back into tune.
Right. There's a couple of reasons I've read and thought about. One is to give you a chance to think about what you're doing. The second, which is probably a lot more logical, if a blacksmith was doing a lot of heavy work with a heavy hammer,
mm-hmm.
that extra little tap gave his arm a rest.
Mm-hmm.
An anvil is basically a wrought iron base with a welded steel top. It's a very dense iron, and when you hit your hammer on it, it bounces right back. So every third or fourth shot, the blacksmith would drop his hammer on the anvil, and he wouldn't have to pick the hammer up to take the next blow.
Yep.
So it was a resting type deal, too.
It was a tiring job, isn't it?
I mean, absolutely.
You're standing all day long on a cement floor, generally. Maybe the old ones had dirt.
The old ones usually had dirt.
But you're standing, and you're using both hands.
Right.
And it gets pretty warm in here in the summer.
Absolutely. On a really warm, humid day, I can go through 2 or 3 gallons of water out here.
You can.
I just drink water all the time.
Now, to make something like you're making right now, how many hours are we talking? Are we talking hours?
This right here is probably an hour and a half.
Okay, now, when you figure what that should sell for, you have to remember that the man is trying to make a living, he's paying expenses. How much is he entitled for an hour and a half? Now, that's to make one unit. So, see the little sparks flying off? Look, like 4th of July all over
right.
again. So, a unit like this, give it, and now he's tempering, or just wet cooling?
Just cooling that off right
cooling
now.
Cooling that off.
Mm-hmm. One of these, I normally try to get $25 to $30,
okay.
depending on what degree of finish they want. What kind of intricacy.
Now, do you paint them afterwards?
Depending. This would be outside. It would be unattended in the weather all the time. I would probably paint this flat black with Rust-Oleum.
Okay. Okay.
If I'm making a really nice piece that's going to be indoors, used often, I'll give it what they call a forge finish. We'll heat it again, wire brush it, hammer it as smooth as we can, and then put a wax on it. Normally a beeswax, paraffin wax works well. It'll draw the wax right into it. You can polish it off a little bit, and it gives a real nice finish, that satin black finish.
George, normally, a blacksmith didn't build or make for inventory much, did he? Unless
no.
it was some, maybe door latches where you know.
Maybe door latches.
Where the continual thing, but.
He would have one or two apprentices there, normally one. Nails, he would have the apprentice making nails full-time, unless mm-hmm. he had something else for him to do.
Okay. You're working in here, now you're working on these rods,
mm-hmm.
and a man comes in and said, I got trouble with my mower blade, it just something happened,
mm-hmm.
can you do something? Everything stopped?
Everything
stopped. Put it aside, right?
Right.
And that's a lot in the normal blacksmith shop.
Absolutely. The blacksmith was there to provide a service, and he couldn't tell people, hey, I don't care about your hay.
Yeah, yeah.
He said, come back tomorrow. No,
yeah,
he wouldn't be in business long.
No, that's
he would have to take care of the customer.
Okay. So now you're doing making, what is this going
this
to be?
This is another part of the same apparatus. So I'm going to draw this one out to a point, too.
Okay.
All three of them would go together.
They go together?
They just loop together to make a tripod shape.
Oh, I see.
This one here would be the primary piece with the extra hook on
uh-huh.
it.
Uh-huh.
Take one of these and slide it over here, and then the third one would go on. You can stick them into the ground.
I see.
And then your pot would hang off of this hook here, right over your campfire.
So when you're talking an hour and a half, you mean the three pieces?
Three pieces.
I see. Okay. Uh-huh.
Those and an hour and a half, sometimes 2 hours, depending on the size of the material.
Now, George, I have a tendency to find corners.
You and me both, and I have.
Have you found these corners?
I found those corners quite often. I'm going to have to do a little changing here. This is
Even if you had a a shield, because that can really do a job.
Yeah, it's light, but still it's a corner.
You know, it's right eye and level. If you turn quick, you know.
You hit it just right, you're going to know about
it. Oh, yes. I would think so.
I put this extension on to try to catch more of the smoke. What I'm going to do is bring the hood down inside of the forge and have a small flue about this height over the top to catch more of the smoke. In the wintertime, when the doors are closed and everything's closed, it can get pretty smoky in here.
Now, that heats up pretty quick.
Oh, yeah. It'll heat real quick. I have the hand crank lower. Some of the modern blacksmiths or more contemporary ones will use an electric blower. They can do things a lot faster. I enjoy this. You have more control over the heat.
You see the heat changing already as it darkens, right? So you got to get it back up real hot again to get it down to the point he wants.
The steel will get almost like silly putty. It's easy to form and bend. Forged steel is a lot stronger than cold bent steel. Iron and steel have a grain almost like wood. When you forge a shape into the iron, the grain will follow that forge if it was hot forged, that grain.
When we talked about those three units, you know, making a tripod, you got to remember that in addition to the hour and a half, he bought three pieces of steel, or a steel long enough that must be nearly a 10-foot piece of steel.
This is going to take a little bit over 10 foot by the time it's done. They come in 20-foot lengths. Your raw materials, unfortunately, or fortunately, whichever way you look, are cheaper than the labor involved.
Yes, but they still are part of your cost.
A tremendous part of my cost
is the coal.
Money and time is the coal.
Yeah.
It's not available locally anymore. The only place I can find this coal is in Rutland. So it's a 6-hour round trip for me just to get
it. Oh, you go get it?
I have to go get it. They don't deliver it.
You can't send it, like, it would be too much at freight cut charges, huh?
There is a company that will sell this coal to you for $12.50 a bag. And then the freight cost is another $12.50 a bag. I can buy this coal for about $8 or $9 and go pick it up myself.
Okay. And you pick up a number of bags.
Right. I usually try to pick up between 10 and 12 bags at a time. You want to take that slag off as much as you can, otherwise you pound it back into the steel and it gives it a real rough finish.
Okay.
That's another thing that's hard to sell today. People think blacksmithing and wrought iron has to be really crude and rough. They want to see a lot of hammer marks in it.
Yeah.
If you talk to any blacksmith that was really proud of his profession, he would go the extra 10 minutes to get all the hammer marks out. And
today, well, that gives an indication that it's handmade.
Right.
Don't think that was an imperfection in the anvil. So they kept removing it and got too big. See this little piece right here? Look. What do you do with that?
That's called a cold hardy. This is the hardy hole, and this would be a cutoff tool. Actually, you would heat a piece of steel till it was red hot. I can do one for you real quick.
And the round hole was for various things. You could also use for bending, huh?
You use for bending. That's bending. That's called a Pritchell hole. You would punch your steel. Blacksmiths didn't always have access to a drill press, either hand-powered, water-powered, or whatever. So instead of drilling a hole, they would have to punch the hole through the steel for attachment purposes or whatever.
And they would...
So they would put their hot piece of steel over the Pritchell hole and drive their punch through it. There's a number of tools that go in that hardy hole. I unfortunately don't have a lot of them. I'm still trying to acquire them and make them. There would be different mandrels that you could put in there that you would make for specialty items, different length cutoff tools. Every part of the anvil had a purpose and a function.
So you've been blacksmithing for how long?
Oh, going on 2 years now, I'd say.
Then I'll bet you're still learning.
Absolutely. Learning every day. And I love learning.
And you learn by mistakes too, don't you?
Well, a blacksmith never makes a mistake.
Oh.
No, if you make a mistake, you just heat it up and redo it.
Oh, excuse me.
So you never make a mistake.
You haven't got there yet.
At least none that you're going to admit to right away. Unless you get caught in the act.
So, now this can be resharpened, obviously.
Right.
Getting a little flat on top. Yep.
When it wears out too much, you can reforge it, and you can draw it back to that shape, and then sharpen it, retemper it.
Are there people making anvils today? Can you buy a new anvil?
You can still buy a new anvil. An anvil equivalent to that would cost you about $1,200.
Now, you heard that right. $1,200.
That tool there, the cutoff tool, that Hardy tool, sells for $70 to $80.
This? $70 to $80. Now, these brackets that hold the anvil don't cost that much.
Nope, those are nails.
They do the job. They do the job.
You watch your cord.
Okay, watch it now.
This tool here. You just put your hot steel on it and cut it off.
Just like that.
Just like that. You didn't want to go all the way through it, because if you continuously hammered on the edge of that, it would not cut as well as you wanted it to. So you go to just about through it and then snap your piece off.
One thing you got to remember, one of the first things you learn, I started blacksmithing. First thing you learn is never pick up your work with your hands.
Absolutely.
Can you remember that?
There's two rules. Never pick up the hot work with your hands. And if you forget rule number one, don't forget where your water tub is. And I've done both.
Yeah, have you, huh? Oh, yeah. That starts to darken, you know, and you kind of forget very quickly.
You can forget in a hurry.
Okay, yeah, here's
the... go together like that. And on the concrete, it's hard, but you would stick them right into the ground on those points.
And this is where you hang your...
hang your pot right over
pot right
point.
There. And you see the...
I can bring that over.
You bring it, put it the other angle for your
Basically,
pot.
Basically, that's an early 18th century apparatus that they would use on the trail.
Okay, now remember, you don't need this to go camping. You got a pot out in the front yard.
Absolutely.
That you'd like to have hanging. There's, you can adapt it to what you want. There's a man that can do it. What's your telephone number, George?
In Moores, it's 236-7340.
Your name's in the phone book?
My name's in the phone book. It's easy to find, the only Weidle in the book.
Hardest place to remember a name, Weidle.
That's right.
Does it? Are you? You doesn't say welding or?
No.
I'm sorry. Not welding, but blacksmithing. Nothing like
no,
that.
No, just George Weidle.
George Weidle.
And actually, this pronunciation kind of camouflages the spelling.
W e i, d e l.
D l e.
D l e. Okay. We'll take another break. See where we are. We're just about finished here at blacksmithing, in. North Star Road, halfway between Champlain and Moores, New York. My daughters will be glad to know that their dad is now a swinger. I came here to talk, and here are George and I on this swinger. Now, you don't know, maybe, that blacksmiths make items of wood. Tell us about this swing.
A woman needed one. She wanted one that would last a long time, so I made it out of pressure treated. It was the most logical and expensive wood. I'm just waiting for it to dry so I can finish sanding it and put a coat of stain on it for her. It's just a long glider, they called it. Just some place to sit in the evening and drink your coffee or relax.
First thing I would do, George, is have you put a roof over it, because I don't like that sun.
That's the next step. There is a roof going on this one.
We saw some very nice gliders last night. They were gliders up in St. John at the scene in front of a senior's building. Instead of swinging, they were gliding, and they had a nice, looked like a building nearly.
Really?
Very nice. Commercially made metal things. Okay. We're here for several reasons, because this is something in our backyard that Calvin and I did not know about. And I don't know how we'd have found out about it except for the good spirit of a lady down in 1812 Homestead where we were. We were talking blacksmithing with the man there. His name is Bill Umber.
Bill Umber.
And I was asking him questions. And I mentioned to him, would you talk with us for full time? And he was, for a whole show. And as you know, we try to get local people as much as possible. We don't want to go 50 miles away somewhere we don't see every day. And that's one reason why we're here. So she contacted you?
She contacted me and said that Calvin would be interested in talking to me. Kristen Gronander, the curator down there. She's a real nice lady. She has a tremendous love for that place. So I thanked her, and I called Calvin, and he said, sure. He said, we'd really like to talk to you.
That's how we got here. And, of course, also, we're very pleased to see this man get some business. That's not why we're here. We're not here to advertise his business, but pretty hard not to when we're here showing you all the great things he does. So we're talking about if you got any metal things that need repair. I don't mean welding. You don't do welding as such.
We do traditional arc welding. I have an AC-DC arc welder.
You can do that.
I have acetylene torches. I can fix most farm machinery here.
Okay, so if there's a piece you need for a piece of farm machinery, you can't get it for whatever reason, or you don't want to pay that heavy price, come down and see George, and George can get right to it. Most of the things you do, you can stop temporarily.
I can stop and
like you're in the middle of another job.
Absolutely.
And he can repair that for you here. And remember, it's 236
7340.
7340. And he's right. What number are you on?
The new 911 number is 596 North Star Road.
596. As you come from Champlain on the North Star Road, leave Perry's Mills, 2 miles, 3 miles?
From Perry's Mills, probably 3 miles.
3 miles, it's on your right. You have to look for this hidden driveway, really.
Absolutely.
And you come back in here, you're going to be impressed. A nice place to live, and I don't know if I would work much, George. I'd like to just sit here and
sometimes it's hard.
Enjoy the surroundings, huh?
Sometimes it's hard.
But your wife says, hey, I go to work.
That's
you
right.
You got to get something done.
I better do something, have something to show for myself at the end of the
day. Okay, so you can make a lot of things in metal.
Absolutely.
You've got the ideas, and you don't have, and then you can, I just went sideways.
And he's a carpenter.
And a carpenter. He's a certified, what do you call it?
Union carpenter.
Union carpenter. And he also, the carpenter work is here along with blacksmithing. You can make these, and I imagine things of this nature. Did you make that bench behind us?
No, that was an Ames bench.
They had
that on sale one time. It's quite a bit. It's probably 12 years old.
All right. Now, let's talk about a bench for a minute. My wife got a bench somewhere, and it's sitting in the yard, and it's really off to one side.
Mm-hmm.
A real old bench. And the wood was painted green, and it was pretty ratty, and it wasn't very sturdy. My son bought some boards that size.
Mm-hmm.
He took the metal pieces off and he painted and whatever he did, fixed them up, straightened them up, and put it all together with these 6 or 7 new boards. And it's a nice looking unit. And it's natural wood. And now it's new, but it's old. It's the old metal.
Right.
And it's a nice old piece. If you need something like that, you can do that. Do you do anything with buckets?
No.
Barrels? No,
that's another profession. That's a cooper.
Okay. So if you want anything at all, if you...
Challenge him.
Challenge him, yes.
Absolutely.
I tried, and I challenged. I brought a piece here. My wife wanted me to kind of, put them together by heating them, and, well, it was cast steel.
Cast iron,
so he's going to try to bronze it.
Braze. Brazing.
See if we can braze those together. And for $50, how much brazing can you get?
Absolutely.
Right? Okay, well, George, we really appreciate your time.
I appreciate you guys coming out.
It's nice meeting you. You're a neighbor. And 18 years late, welcome to the North Country.
Thank you very much, sir. But I've been welcomed, and I feel welcome here.
Very good.
It's a nice community.
And I see you've got the traditional apron on.
Yeah, I learned the hard way. If you're going to do any welding, them sparks really fly.
You burn yourself very often on your arm?
Not too often. It all depends how big a job you're doing, how much welding you have to do. Normally, you don't heat the iron that much where you get a lot of sparks flying, so you don't get burnt too often.
Biggest problem is not doing it, it's forgetting what
Absolutely.
You're doing, I would think.
Absolutely. At welding heat with the right size iron, if you were to try to catch a piece that dropped, it could cut your finger off and cauterize it in a second.
So let me bring two things to your mind. When you come here, or any other place a man is working on tools, he's working on some equipment, do not yell and say hello or anything like that when his back is to you. Wait until he sees you. Don't get right on top of him. Stay back and wait, because you can lose a finger. You
Absolutely.
Can do a lot of things, right?
Absolutely.
He's not thinking of your coming. Excuse me. So I ask you, and that or anybody who's working of that kind of work, don't surprise them. Just stand back and wait. They take a lot of short breaks, and it's safer for them and everybody else.
Absolutely.
Anything else, George, you want me to cover?
No, not really. I'm really glad you guys came. I really appreciate it. It's been interesting and a lot of fun.
Another of the programs that the Hometown Table, Calvin and Sam, bring to you. This is over, we're well over, 515 or 20 different places that I've been involved in over these 8 years. And I probably got a chance to meet this man. I would never meet him otherwise unless first of all, I'd have to have heard about him. You're a well-kept secret.
Thank you.
You haven't done a lot of advertising.
No, I haven't done any advertising at all. I'm trying to go by word of mouth. Hopefully reputation will suffice.
Mm-hmm.
The more I do it, I think the more people learn where I am, what I can do. I prefer custom work. I really don't like to try to make trinkets. I like to make functional items, as a traditional blacksmith would have.
Okay. This man is out. You see him from time to time. You're not going to forget that beard and that face. And if you see him, say hi. If you don't remember his name, say hi. I saw you on Hometown Cable. I enjoyed talking. I felt like I was talking to you myself. And just tell him thanks for being on Hometown Cable. We thank you. And in closing, one more time. Calvin mentions it in most programs, and that's become a patron, Hometown Cable. Calvin doesn't sell a product. He sells some advertising, which is a non-product. But he does ask for some volunteers to say, hey, I like what you're doing out there. Send him 10, 15, or I should say 12, he asked for. 12, 15, 20, or more. And say, I'd like to join in with the others who patronize, become patrons of Hometown Cable. This past week, two different people gave me a check. Maybe it's 10 days. To give to Calvin, and I'm always ready to take those. I sometimes wish my name was on them, but it's not, so I pass them along to Calvin. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you next Sunday. Thanks, George.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Hometown Cable, our program, as ever, on